investments in residential projects directed at the middle-income and low-income households in India. On the panel, I am joined by Mr. Deo Singh Tripathi. Mr. Tripathi is the Chief Executive Officer of Aadhar Home Finance Limited, which is a joint venture between DHFL and IFC of Washington. Aadhar Home Finance Limited, by its charter, is mandated to focus exclusively on the low-income groups or low-income families in India, to which it provides home finance or mortgage finance. Together, we will handle the presentation. This presentation will be followed by a question and answer session. All participants can use the controls on your screen to send us questions even while the presentation is on. With a hope that we have an informative, interesting, and a very lively discussion, I'm now handing over the mic to Mr. Tripathi to start the presentation.
Thank you, Vikram sir. Good evening and welcome to the webinar.
We all know there is a huge shortage of houses in India. Why does it exist? Mainly because the, in Indian context, the penetration of housing to GDP is hardly 9%, while in most emerging economies in Asia itself, it is from 17 to 30%. In India, the working population is quite young. They have a lot of aspiration to get their house at the early age. At the same time, the lifestyles are changing. They want to go to luxury houses. Nuclear family is one of the contributing factor, and much more important is the influx of migrant population, skilled and unskilled, both in cities, for in the hope of getting an employment. And that huge population which is coming to cities, that is creating an acute housing shortage, which creates more and more slums in the cities. In fact, the housing supply itself is insufficient, and whatever supply we have in cities, it is exorbitantly very high, which many people can't afford. And even the builder, if you want to reduce the cost, the cost of land is too high, it is becoming difficult for them. If you see that housing supply was there, but the mismatch exists between these, because the people to whom for the houses were built are not those, the people who need the houses. That is the reason the number of slums are day by day increasing. The number of slums are 33,510, the highest being in Maharashtra, followed by Andhra, West Bengal, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, and so on and so forth. The number of households in India itself are more than 88 lakhs. The main reason is that urban population, which has grown to 31% now, is set to grow about 40% by 2030 and 50% by 2050. Under these circumstances, there has to be a problem of houses in the country. Now, coming to the point that there is a huge shortage in India, which is clearly reflected by the technical group which was engaged by the Ministry of Housing and Urban and Poverty Alleviation. They came out with the report that from 2012 to 17, in cities itself, in the urban sector itself, 18.78 million shortage of units is there. Largely 96% of the unit is from EWS and LIG, 56% in EWS and 40% in LIG, and about 4% in MIG. The concentration is again in top 10 states is 75%, starting from UP, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, AP, and so on and so forth. Now, if you come to that, there is an insufficient supply of affordable housing unit, which results the massive congestion and slums in the cities. Everybody has got a shelter. The concept of shelter has to change to the concept of habitation. And unless we have an habitation, the things will not improve and people will not have the bare basic minimum amenities to live at. The KPMG carried out a study that the shortage which was ascertained by the group for 2012 to 17 is all set to increase by 2.6 crore to 2.9 crore by 2022. It means the present shortage of about 1.9 crore is going to be 4.4 crore by 2022. That clearly shows the massive shortage in the country. And again, the 75% shortage will remain in UP, MP, Tamil Nadu, Andhra, West Bengal, Delhi, Gujarat, Karnataka, and so on and so forth. But by 2022, the composition is likely to change because the efforts this government is putting in for EWS LIG, they may change the composition. Then EWS, which is now at 56%, will come down to 40%. LIG, which is at now 40%, may come down to 30%. And MIG, which is at present is 4%, may go to 20%, and HIG at 10% by 2022. What is the market opportunity for the lenders and for the builder? If you, the shortage which I have just now spoken to you, if you simply multiply the cost of dwelling unit, roughly about 54 lakhs crore are required for construction of these houses which are required up to 2022, and there is a lending opportunity for 46 lakhs crore for all segment, which is will be high for the EWS because they do not have so much of money to contribute. There has to be loan amount requirement will be 90% of the dwelling unit. In LIG, it may go to 80%, 90%. And MIG and HIG, it may slightly again come down. That is why 46 less crore is going to be the lending requirement. There is a huge opportunity for builder, for the state government housing bodies, and for the individual people to put in money in this segment to create India with the houses to everyone with minimum basic amenities. Coming to the affordable housing definition, everybody can interpret the affordable housing in a different way. Actually, the affordable housing is for every segment is differing. Whatever the median income for a particular segment is there, below that median income, the affordability is defined for a person to buy a house. Reserve Bank of India, a few months back, has come out with the affordable housing definition to clearly focus for the lending institution and for providing the various other assistance to builder. That is why they said that in metros, if the cost of dwelling unit is 65 and loan amount requirement is 50 lakhs or below, it is unaffordable. In other cities, if 50 lakhs rupees is the cost of dwelling unit and the loan amount will be 40 lakhs and below. For the purpose of priority sector lending for the commercial banks, they have a different definition because RBI wants that there should be more focus on LIG and MIG houses. Therefore, they have mentioned that 28 lakhs rupees in metropolitan cities and 20 lakhs rupees in other centers, loan amount will be treated as the priority sector lending. If you populate it in terms of the income, roughly about in other centers, people who are getting 16.5 lakhs and below income, they will be qualifying for the affordable housing, maybe 10 lakhs to 16.5 lakhs rupees. And metropolitan centers, roughly about 20 lakhs, 0.6 lakhs and below, or you can say 15 lakhs, 20 lakhs rupees they can get. And for the purpose of priority sector, it is around 8 lakhs and 11 lakhs rupees. The annual income has to be there. It is just we worked out on the basis of the interest rate prevailing and all that, but the RBI is only giving the ticket size of the loan and the cost of dwelling unit for the purpose of affordable housing scheme. The government has recently announced the housing policy for 2022, the National Housing Mission, and they have clearly defined EWS and LIG. They have increased the income level of EWS and LIG to see that the people can get in a better house, maybe 1BK, 1BHK or 2BHK. For EWS, the income level is 3 lakhs and below. For LIG, the income level is 6 lakhs and below. And dwelling unit cost, they have mentioned, they should not exceed 25 lakhs rupees because in that only they can take the loan. The government has also mentioned carpet area, but they are not rigid. They have said the carpet area has to be minimum 323 square feet in case of EWS and 323 to 646 in case of LIG. For MIG, it is taken as 600 to 1200. The government has not defined, but many organizations have already defined it. The carpet area exceeds, because in some cities, if the cost of dwelling unit is less, the person, the beneficiary can go for a little higher carpet area. The government, RBI or government, they are not worried about that. They have not put any higher ceiling for that. income criteria I have seen, on the basis of the income criteria, an EWS person can take the loan of about, you can say, 8, 9, 9, 10 lakhs rupees and a house of 13 lakhs rupees, and LIG can take a house of 25 or 26 lakh rupees. He can clearly take from 9.7 lakhs, 25 lakhs rupees. Therefore, a wide coverage is available for people to get in a good house. The government, to improve the supply side, has also taken a lot many initiative in this mission. They have clearly told that 35% of dwelling unit, if are of EWS category, and the carpet area less than 30 square meter in a particular builder project, that project will be deemed as the EWS, and the builder will be eligible for the capital subsidy, because government has earmarked two subsidies, one for demand subsidies and for supply side subsidies. The builder can get 1.5 lakh rupees subsidy per dwelling unit, but of course in that case the government will decide how the allotment and all to be done. So it is a good opportunity for builder to focus on the mass EWS houses. For the purpose of raising resources by the builder, the affordable housing project FDI is also allowed 100%, and the 100% FDI has got a simple definition which has not been changed, where the 40% FAR of the FSAI and the plot size and the floor area has to be less than 140 square meter. So it is giving a lot of flexibility to the builder to create the affordable housing segment and take the money through FDI route. But in this case, 25% of FAR FSAI for affordable housing has to be there, where the house area should not be more than 60 square meter. We will clearly see that government wants that if you make a big project, you earmark something for EWS, LIG and MIG, and rest you can make for a commercial exploitation. That's why they are not worried about the your selling.